Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Understanding God's Loving Laws group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the session 2, reminders and homework review presentation, Mary works through reminders from the previous order principles session and reviews the homework. Recorded on the 11th of November 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
Our first presentation this morning is reminders from session 2 and looking at your homework. I hope you enjoyed your homework and fit it in amongst other festivities yesterday. So let's have a look. What I'm going to do as we go through this presentation is we'll look at each of the principles that we presented in the last session, and while we're revising those, I'll talk to you about your homework. And as it was last time, almost your homework is the revision of the principle, hopefully. When we get to the responsibility principles, we'll ask you those additional questions, because as Jesus and I have mentioned, that's a really big focus for us in this group, helping you to understand what responsibility principles are all about and this concept of self-responsibility. So let's get to it. Before we do that, I'm just going to remind you of a few things that the order principles were all about. Or maybe you can help me. We'll see how we go. All right. Now, this is the last time you're going to see this particular diagram, because in our next, in my next presentation this morning, I'll be introducing a new layer to this that I know a lot of you already have burning questions about. But this one is our understanding of really what we're here to talk about, and it still applies. We're just going to be adding a bit more to it later on. But a reminder, we're here discussing the principles that govern the laws of the universe in the hierarchical form that they are. And these principles are, they tell us a lot about God's character and nature, don't they? They're governed by God's character and nature. They're a reflection of God's character and nature. And so this is a lovely way that you can begin to open up towards God, isn't it? By coming to appreciate those things. Yes, but we've been talking about the principles, the laws that they govern, the hierarchy, which was part of your homework, that they exist within, and then how that applies to all of God's creation. And we learned in the last session, didn't we, that all of God's creation exists within a hierarchy. And we'll talk more about that in our next talk as well. So all of the laws are in a hierarchy and all of the creations are in a hierarchy. So that's all okay with everyone?
Yeah.
That's good. All right, who would like to remind me a little bit about what the order principles were all about? And in these questions, I'm asking you this because it helps you to conceptualize really. Remember, we had the foundations and we learnt that applies to everything and that enables creation to exist. And then we talked about order principles and that told us a bit more about God and creation, didn't it? So who can remember the basics about order principles? Felix?
So the order principles are about how the human soul fits into the universe and the effect it has on the creation.
Yes, yes, excellent. Very good. So it's not just about creation. Now we're focusing a bit more on the soul and how it fits in. Now someone else had their hand up over here, did they? No? Yep. Marion?
What role the soul has in the universe.
Yes, yeah. Yes, exactly. So that's what order principles was all about. So let's have a look. How we fit into the universe, how we affect the universe, how our soul affects the lower creations within the hierarchy, and what is our role within the universe. And do you feel that you learnt some about that in session 2? Yeah, yeah. And as I mentioned at our close the other day, this is a process of learning. So, you know, it's fine to still be processing and bit confused about certain points, because it'll become clearer as you become more familiar with everything. Okay, we discussed what were the principles. You can call them out with me. Who remembers back that far? Hierarchy, governance, responsibility, compensation. Wow, you guys are awesome. Even I was thinking, that's right. All right. And the two presentations we had, who remembers? Law-related attitudes and emotions and the hangover, the famous hangover. Yes. Okay. So we'll just talk a little bit about the attitudes and emotions. Remember this very important point, that if we're to become at one with God, we're going to have to get God's feelings and attitudes, aren't we? Especially about God's laws. And what happens when we don't have those attitudes and emotions? What do we create? Sin. And that's our creation, isn't it? Not God's. So whenever we have a different attitude or emotion than God does, we're automatically sinning and therefore creating more pain and suffering for ourselves. All right. We talked a little bit, we talked a lot, but I'll just mention here briefly that obviously our childhood experiences had a big impact, didn't they, on our attitudes and emotions towards law. And I feel like you guys had some good discussion with Jesus about what that was all about and a few good aha moments of like, yeah, wow, unless I actually change some of this stuff, my attitudes and emotions towards law are going to remain the same. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Let's talk about the hangover briefly. This helped us see the massive difference, didn't it, between God's laws and why God creates laws and how God creates laws and how it happens on earth in our families and in our current societal systems. And we talked again about the sin and the pain that comes from sin. And a lot of you had some great input there about just really what is your specific hangover and what you feel you should get away with and what you feel shouldn't apply. And that's really good stuff for you to focus on going away from this group as well, because they're, again, all the things that are blocking you in this relationship with God. And to your happiness, to your future happiness. Okay. Now let's have a look at your principles, and this is where I'd love to hear from you guys about your homework. So remember our first principle in this second session was hierarchy, and this was all about the hierarchy of law and the hierarchy of creation and the complexity of each of those and how that places them in the hierarchy, wasn't it? The more complex the creation, the higher it is in the hierarchy, and the more complex laws govern it, and so on. And it ensures that the higher creations and laws exert more power and have more energy over those in the lower parts of the hierarchy. So how did you guys feel? Let's look at our question. You were in or out of harmony with those principles. Did anyone have any ideas? Yeah. If we go to Glenn and Ivana. So we'll go to Glenn first, yep.
Because particularly in the past, I haven't wanted to know about the hierarchy system.
Mm-hmm.
I'm completely in sin because, one, I don't want to know because I don't know. Otherwise, I would be given the opportunity to know. And this is a big
thing. So you're out of harmony even in the fact that you just wanted to be ignorant.
Because I didn't even know about it.
Yeah. All right. Okay, Ivana?
I'm not sure if this is right, but because with God's perspective, we're all equal, when I feel inferior or superior to other people, like, is that being out of harmony?
Yes, definitely. Yep. Definitely. Good observation. Okay. Who else had some ideas? There was someone right up the back. We'll hear from Carol, is it? Yep. And who else on this side had an idea? Anna? Yep. Where's our? Yep. There we go.
By believing that God may not be perfect and humans may be the flawed creation he made while practicing.
Yeah. Yes. It kind of absolves us of a lot of things, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Anna?
I have experienced myself as a solitary in relationship with other people and stuff. And this made me realize more that I am a creation or life within life that made it a new view of experiencing myself.
Yeah. So you, sorry, go keep going.
Yeah. So yeah. What I have been out of the hierarchy principle is that I have seen myself as a solitary.
And this idea of your connection and your effect on other things is that's what you were sort of ignoring or not wanting to feel about.
Yes. Exactly.
Yeah. 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 Okay. Lovely. Thank you. I'll have a look at some things I wanted to remind you of. Yeah, we can come to Rita. And did anyone else on this side have any ways they're breaking hierarchy? No? We'll go to Rita and then we'll...
Not trusting that I have a place wherever I am and that I don't need to try to put myself higher or lower with willpower and ego desire and that I'm lacking humility.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, this idea of putting ourselves higher or lower and trying to force that. Yeah, yeah, lovely. Okay, some things I thought to highlight with you guys. There's actually a lot here in hierarchy. Did you guys struggle with that a little bit? There's not many hands up. Just nobody wants to talk about it publicly. That's all right. Some really simple things, like with veganism. A lot of people feel like they become a vegan because they love animals, and yet at the same time, they're willing to treat other creations higher in the hierarchy with a lot of anger and hatred and like other people who eat meat, there's often a lot of angst towards them, which is really not respecting the hierarchy, isn't it? And you'd have to question how much real love is going towards the animals in that case, or I do. Because if we really have a desire to be compassionate and to love, it's not just reserved for animals, it's for everyone, isn't it? Yeah, yeah. What about this? Placing more importance on people in a lower condition of love than considering or trusting those in a higher condition of love. That's a big one that I notice. It's a lot of consideration given to people in a lower condition of love, a lot of service even to people who are in a lower condition of love. Do you see that? Yeah. Arita, you want to ask something, is it?
Isn't it because we can relate to the ones who are in a lower condition, but we can't relate to the ones who are in a higher condition?
No. What is the reason why? Who do your son wants to answer? Yeah.
We want to pander to those in a lower condition because of, you know, fear of anger and stuff like that.
Yeah, we don't want to experience our fear of those people, and so they end up getting more of our emotional attention and more of our energy. And we can talk more about that in our later principles as well. What about the importance we place on creations? So things we create or things that God has created, creations that are addictive or creations that don't actually benefit anyone else, placing them as higher importance in our life than things that are actually quite good for everyone. You know, a lot of us have these kind of, we call them personal pursuits or activities or things that we like to gather that are not often really meaningful creations at all, are they? They're much lower in a hierarchy. Yeah. Okay. What about this one? The lack of faith that there are inbuilt and external rules and systems that correct our health, correct our attractions, and make life better as long as we're in harmony with God's principles. I notice that a lot. There's a big lack of faith in us, isn't there, in these inbuilt rules and systems that God has put into all of creation, really, even in the corrective nature of things in nature, the corrective properties and inbuilt systems, things in nature. Very often humans don't want to work with them. They want to override them, don't they? Which is really an ignorance of some of the key points in this principle. Yeah. And the last one I had was when we disown or we say we're powerless to stop sinning or to stop the effects of sin, which is all our creation. And this goes back a little bit to what Carol was saying earlier. Yeah. So if we go to Dave at the back, yep.
And for me, it's like I don't believe on the pinnacle of God's creation.
Yeah, it's funny, isn't it? There's a lot of injuries that we have about that. Like sometimes if we think about it, though, we think, we feel like, oh, no, that's the truth. But then sometimes we act like we're the pinnacle of everyone because we don't want to feel an emotion or because we just want this addiction met and we forget about everyone else. But you're right, Dave, all of the injuries that are surrounding that truth create a lot of disharmony with this principle. Yeah, thank you. Does anyone want to add any other reflection about how they're out of harmony with hierarchy before I move on to our next one? Suzanne?
Try really hard not to get into story.
Just hold the mic.
I would like to publicly apologise to Jesus for being really rude to him yesterday in the pool. And he was very kindly trying to bring some clarity to something that I'd raised. And it had to do with Donald Trump.
So let's not go there.
Okay.
Yeah. No worries. Does it relate to this?
I really think it does.
So can you just quickly say how you felt you're out of harmony with the principle?
Because I was in judgment of somebody external.
Yep.
And I'd been making myself feel superior by being in extreme judgment of that person, when in fact the emotions that I was having were relative really to my relationship with my father that I'm not dealing with.
Mm. Yep, okay. Thank you. All right. Let's move on. What was our next one? Who remembers? Governance. All right. This principle ensures that God is the ultimate authority, and you'll hear more about this today. It ensures that all of God's laws control and govern creation, but it allows us to share in governance, doesn't it? So, when you were reflecting on this in your homework exercise, how did you feel you were either in or out of harmony with this principle? Shula and Diane on the other side.
I still do a little bit, give away my power to angry people, mm-hmm. and pander to them.
Yes, yes. And who else can see that they have an issue with governance with that issue, where you're pandering, like we talked about earlier? And remember Jesus, when he was explaining in the Q&A about this principle, he drew that lovely picture of the soul that wasn't very developed in love, gaining power, gaining governance over others through each of us giving them power. Yeah. So I think that one applies to just about everyone on the planet at the moment. Yeah. Okay, Diane?
I feel I'm more powerful than God and that God should share governance with me.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep. Yeah, who else feels they're pretty invincible? Superhuman? That authority, nothing like my personal ability. How's it working out? Not that good. All right, who else had one for governance? If we go to Pamela, just there, and on this side, Raj. Yeah.
I've noticed that because I have a little bit of intellectual knowledge, I think I can fix other people without reference to their free will or to my condition.
So you're trying to exert authority over them almost.
Well, I think I can fix them without fixing myself.
Yeah. The irony is until we fix ourselves, we've got no idea how anyone else can fix themselves. Thanks Pamela. Raj?
Yeah, I'm completely out of awareness of the principle of governance and thereby harmony for my part in the structure and living without acknowledging that I have control over my own creations, including the primary activities in which I invest my time and energy. I also don't acknowledge God's authority to the degree expressed through the laws,
mm-hmm.
and I resort to self-reliance
mm-hmm.
and exerting pressure to achieve, which is demonstrated by the pain and lack of fulfillment in my life.
Mm-hmm. It's a nice point that Raj has highlighted there about that self-reliance is really in opposition to God's authority, isn't it? Yeah. And that is a direct relationship to our pain. Yeah. Okay, if we come to Felix, yep.
I have a feeling of being incapable of achieving or doing stuff, like a lack of faith that God actually built me to, be responsible and be able to do things and be,
yep.
Yeah, that makes sense, yeah.
Yep, that makes sense, And if we look back here at our final point, is it even as well, Felix, this feeling like I don't even want to see that I'm already governing over things that I'm doing? Like, how many of us have that feeling? Like, yeah, I don't want to know that I govern that thing that I just did or that even that I tried to do, you know, but it's happening automatically and a lot of us want to avoid that. Yeah. Okay. I'll have a look at some of the ones I had. Yeah, one of the points I had written down was avoiding governance over our own creations. And you see this sometimes when people, sometimes related to divine truth, but sometimes just related to anything, people make a forum or they hold an event or something, and then they take absolutely no responsibility for what goes on there. They're denying their own governance of that creation, and also in a way they're denying the automatic governance that's happening through their soul condition by just denying that they have anything to do with it, not policing it, not really having any sort of guidelines or rules about what goes on there themselves in terms of their own governance. And then they just also ignore what they're attracting through their automatic governance in that place. And that's a big way we avoid governance principles. Yeah. Okay. Denying the effects of our own governance over other creations. This is a huge thing, and Jesus spoke about that a little bit, about, you know, the meat eating and how everyone thinks, well, lions eat meat, therefore I should eat meat. And sort of that's sort of saying that, well, we should let the behaviour of animals, a lower creation, govern our behaviour. Instead of saying, well, no, actually something in me, I'm higher in the hierarchy, is governing this creation. Yeah. Did anyone have anything along those lines in there, Jesus, you want to add?
Dallin, it wasn't along those lines, but it was along the lines of sickness, disease and accidents.
Yes.
You've already got that, I think, in your list. It's just, I feel that's a big one for majority of people who we still talk to, really. It's most people are still, you know, looking for physical solutions to sickness, disease and accidents rather than seeing that there is a love base, there's a love base reason why those particular things are happening. Yeah. And therefore, we're not having governance over our own creation, so we're not seeing sickness or disease or accidents as our own creation. We always want to blame something else or someone else or the body or God or something other than oneself for them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Definitely. It's like our soul's governing everything, hey, and we're just saying, nothing to do with me. Yeah. Jules?
I had that same belief of governance when I was teaching as well as when I was a mother.
Uh-huh.
And it was always what I thought was right and had nothing to do with any of God or God's laws, and I never taught that, and I never mentioned it to my daughter, so there was a lot
Got you. Yeah. It's interesting as a parent, isn't it? Because really, if we were a parent who honoured God's authority, who respected God's authority ourselves, then, well, parenting would be a breeze for a start. And also we wouldn't try to be the authority over our child, would we? Which a lot of you now can sort of start to feel how damaging that was, especially when it was out of harmony with
love. I was the higher authority, I believed.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. Couple more I'll mention here. What about this one? Who's done this one? Desiring power without development or skill. Yeah, we'd like to, you know, be in charge and tell everyone else what to do. We don't really know what they have to do, or we can't do it ourselves, but we'd like the status there, thank you. We've earned our stripes, I don't know how, but, you know, that's a feeling, isn't it, often? Yep. That's the basis along with what Jesus said of what I had. Did anyone else have anything different to any of those? Yeah, if we come to Christine, and then we've got Anna beside you.
I've come to realise that my every thought and attitude has an effect, not just my action. Yeah. So I'm not actually ever not doing anything.
Yes. How did that make you feel? I remember having a feeling some years ago of like, I can't get away from sin, no matter, even if I just sit here like a blob forever, I'm still sinning. Yeah. Because of what's in here. Yeah, yeah. Awesome. Thank you, Christine. And Anna was next.
I am lazy sometimes, so I don't explore and find out for myself. I ask someone else to do the thing for me.
Yes. Yeah. So that is similar to what I was saying before about the desiring. We're nearly getting into some of the future principles as well, aren't we? But yeah, the desiring to hand off things to someone else rather than do them yourself.
Take responsibility for it, to find out it myself and get the pleasure and satisfaction of doing that.
Yeah.
So just leaving.
To create asking. For yourself, hey? Because this principle does allow us to create.
Yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. All right, I want to get on to... Yes, it's time. It's time, guys. Let's go to the hot topic. All right. Now, responsibility principles. Remember we talked to you about three key sort of terms, we called them, in relation to responsibility principles. This isn't the entirety of the principle, but these were key terms, remember? So we talked to you about your nature. I won't go through reading them all out because we'll refer back to it as we do your homework. Self-responsibility, and this was a key part of your homework, wasn't it? And remember when we closed the other night, I was saying to you that this... there were some key parts to the definition of the law-based requirement involved and the seeking, desirous feeling involved in self-responsibility. Yes. All right. And then we talked about role responsibility, which was impossible in God's universe without self-responsibility. Okay. This was what the principles enforce, really. They enforce ultimate self-responsibility. Whether we like it or not, that's where we're headed, but a lot of us are fighting that process, aren't we? And that's the very opposite of what self-responsibility is actually all about, because in order to be self-responsible, you've got to want it. That's a part of the massive part of it. You've got to seek and desire these to live in harmony with these principles. Okay. They also encourage us to be self-responsible. And they allow God to have this system of rewarding self-responsibility with role responsibility. So, first homework question was, how am I living in or out of harmony with the responsibility principles? Who, if we go to Tris, and then we'll come to Thalia.
I realised very early on, I don't actually have a desire for responsibility. As a soul-based feeling of desire to seek is a problem for me. So I won't be thorough. I'll even be demanding and negotiate and hide and conveniently forget details, both consciously and unconsciously, just so I don't have to deal with my desire of self-responsibility, because that's something I seem to not want at all.
Yeah, well, it's almost like you not doing those things is indicating the lack of desire, isn't it? The fact that those behaviours exist is all a flow-on effect from the fact that inside of your heart you don't really want, your motivation is not, I want to be self-responsible. Yeah, yeah. Okay, and who was over here, Thalia? Yep.
Cool. Practically, like, bit similar, like just basically most of my life, I'll just read it. You know, I was desperate to be saved and have my pain taken away, and I placed extremely high expectations and demands upon friends, relationships to fill like the big void and hole that I desperately wanted to fill. And I just didn't want to take responsibility for my life or pain that I had created.
Mm-hmm.
So
yes,
that's been a big issue.
A big issue. And a lot of us have that big issue where we feel like this emotional stuff I've got inside of me. I want someone else to help me get through it or to fix it for me. And that is if we go back to our definition. Whoops. There we are. It's really the opposite, isn't it, of seeking love and truth for ourselves. We're actually demanding people give that to us in a way, except not always even truth, is it? We just want, yeah. Okay, yeah. Thank you. If we go to Kelly and then Deirdre. And we'll work our way back there.
When I reject the teachings and gifts I have been shown, you know, like I don't use the tools that I've been shown to use. I've got them and I don't want to use them, so I reject them. I want to, ignore that I've got them. And
again, this is like a behaviour, isn't it? That's an effect of a lack of desire.
Yes,
and remember, self-responsibility is all about the desire for these things, the desire to earnestly seek truth and love and understand the principles of love and law. If that desire was there, you wouldn't ignore them, would you?
True, yeah.
And this is a really important part of understanding self-responsibility, is that it's a heart condition. You know, it's a condition in the heart that then has flow-on effects in our life. Yeah, thanks, Kel. All right, Deirdre?
Because I don't have self-responsibility in a lot of areas, I realise the harm it caused me is I purposefully ensure my ineligibility for a role responsibility, and this will create a huge amount of regret in me, which will cause me more pain, heartache, misery and long-term suffering that is, I believe, will be far more greater than any terror that I'm currently suppressing.
Just pause for a moment. Who else can relate to this idea of looking at, well, I don't want to be self-responsible, but what's the effect of that in the long term? A lot of us don't think about that when we're in our just desire to be not responsible. Mm-hmm. But it's true that time spent avoiding self-responsibility, there's, because of cause and effect, there's an effect of that, and it's pain, yeah. And regret is a very severe pain, isn't it? Yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay, thanks, Deirdre. Bruce, yeah.
I sort of thought I was a fairly responsible person, but what I really find is I'm responsible in that I, in light of society's guidelines, how society wants me to be responsible, not about how God wants me to be responsible.
Yes, because, hey, did anyone else notice how different those two things are? Remember Dave asked at the end, should I be thinking about what I think it means to be self-responsible and how God feels about self-responsibility? Like on earth, it's almost like we're taught, well, get up, tie your shoelaces, make your breakfast, wash up, you know, pay the bills, do all the right things that society's asking of us and not rely on anyone else, well, then you're a self-responsible person. Now, if you contrast that with God's definition, it's totally different, isn't it? This is all about seeking love, seeking truth because you want to, because you're motivated to internally. Like I can do all those things like get up, brush my teeth, do the washing up, go to work, pay the bills, da-da-da, and hate every minute of it and wish I didn't have to do it, which means by God's definition, I'm not self-responsible at all. And, of course, God's definition goes a lot beyond just the physical, doesn't it? It's all about desiring and understanding of these laws and of love and the ownership and expression of one's will. Who had some reflections about that? Yvonne, what did you... Because we were going to go to you anyway.
Oh, it was very clear for me. I want role responsibility and I don't even understand self-responsibility, let alone have the desire to seek it out and to take ownership.
In fact, partly why you want role responsibility is because you want to avoid self-responsibility.
Yeah,
did anyone else notice that?
Yeah. I just want to skip right over that.
Yeah, well, because then I can pretend I know all the laws and I can get all my addictions met, which is not really seeking love and truth at all, and then everything's great. I've got a role. just ask anyone, I'm important, you know. And it's actually because we don't want to do these things. Mm. And a lot of you, as Jesus has mentioned a lot of times, want to be told, what is my passionate desire in life, you know, which is kind of a funny question. It's such a personal thing. But if I have a role, well, then maybe, you know, a lot of people are like, what career should I choose? Because without one, I feel lost, you know. Mm. I feel like, oh, I don't have an identity. When really, and then I'll get one, and then I feel like, no, this is who I am. And it's could have nothing to do with your own nature. But you're trying to get this role to avoid those things.
Thank you. Yeah. That's helpful. Yeah.
Okay. We'll have one more, and then we'll go into the next questions. If we go to Dave... There's someone else I want to come to over here, yeah.
If responsibility principles are will-based, by giving my will away, I'm not being responsible, and I'm actually making someone else responsible for me and for what I do.
Yes, totally true. Great observation. And who else does that? Yeah, a lot of us do it for a lot of reasons a lot of the time, yeah. I'll just read you guys a few of the ones that I had written down specific to the principles, because I really want to hear from you on the next questions. Okay. Incurring expenses and then not paying for them. So, yeah, I want to buy that thing. That might even be an expression of myself. Then when the bill comes, no, I don't even want to take responsibility for paying that, you know, and it's a feeling. You might still pay the bill, but the feeling is, no, I don't want to be responsible for everything involved in the loving ownership of my desire, my will. What about this, earth changes are happening, I've got to start growing my own food and I've got to understand all this stuff and I've got to, look, I'm really responsible now, I'm not relying on the world around me at all. Is this a love-based desire to understand and to express my will? No, it's all fear, isn't it? Yeah. It's out of harmony. And this is how on earth we can have the illusion, the delusion, the facade. I'm a very responsible person, but the heart is not responsible at all. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Look, there's lots, but maybe we'll get on to the next questions, because maybe you guys will come up with some of these. And if not, I'll go through all of them again at the end. So, who had some thoughts about what they think it means to be fully self-responsible in their own life? Was that a hard question? Who haven't we heard from? Who? Teresa? You've got to wait for the... Yep.
Well, that God has designed us so we're completely accountable and own everything we feel, say and do. And that everything that we think, say, and do and feel has an impact on us and others.
Yes.
And this is just and fair and means that everything and every little thing in my soul has an impact on me and others, good or bad, and nothing has got away. You don't get away with anything.
Yeah. So all that's truth. And when you're self-responsible, you passionately desire to know and acknowledge that. You see the issue with self-responsibility? It's not just knowing truth or living in harmony with truth. It's like wanting to know. It's like when you're a little kid and you're so excited to find out, like, Mummy, why is the sky blue or whatever? You know, that's the feeling. And this feeling, because you're exactly correct, God has designed me to be accountable and all those things. But when I'm self-responsible, I want to know that. And in fact, I want to know, how's God making me accountable right now? What is this little thing that just happened? Is God trying to show me, definitely trying to show me something with that? You know, what is that all about? And that's what a self-responsible person is like. You start to get the flavour for self-responsibility. It's very much about not your actions, not even the physical things in your life. It's about your attitude to all of those things. Make sense? Yeah. Okay, if we go to who was next, Jenny H. And was there anyone on this side who had some... Yep, we'll go to Hunter.
Through looking at the principle, I've come face to face with my own self-pity, and that I get angry and choose anger, and then I get in this spiral, and none of it is about taking responsibility for my life or for my choices or for the impact on other people.
Yeah. A lot of us, what we're doing is, if I go back to our definition again, instead of actively seeking truth, love and understanding of principles of love and law, a lot of us at certain times are actively seeking to avoid truth, love and understanding of love and law. When we're in our addictions, when we're in self-pity and blame and all of those things, that's really our heartfelt desire, isn't it? Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Hunter, I'll just check my time. Yep. Okay.
Repenting for my sins and forgiving the sins others have put on me, and living God's way instead of regurgitating her laws and principles without believing them in my soul.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And living God's way because you want it, because you love it, because you believe in God's authority and you, yeah. But, and you're right, forgiveness and repentance is a huge part of self-responsibility. It comes almost as a natural effect of self-responsibility. Can you see that? When I'm seeking the truth, seeking truth, love and understanding of love and law, and I want to have the loving ownership of myself, then I automatically begin the process of forgiveness and repentance. So you can see why we really wanted to stress this with you guys. Hey, yeah, yeah. Okay, I'll just have a little look at the other stuff I had here. Maybe if we come to Jennifer finally, and then, because I have to move on because we have to finish. So we could talk about this for a week on its own, honestly, and I'd probably love to, but we don't have time. Go ahead, Jennifer.
Okay, I wonder, can we be truly, fully self-responsible when we have not accepted our facade or deconstructed it?
This, what do you think?
I was left feeling rather confused from the other day. So,
well,
and I was wondering, who gives role responsibility? Where does that? Sorry, there was just a whole lot of questions I was left with rather than answers.
Rather than answers, yeah. Well, what does everyone else think about the issue of facade? If I'm holding on to my facade, can I be self-responsible? No. No, because the facade is driven by the desire, again, to avoid truth, to present an untruth. Yeah.
Okay, can I ask another question then?
Yes, not really the time for questions, but yes, go ahead.
Oh,
quickly.
Yeah. Can we be fully self-responsible in one area of our life and not in another and receive role responsibility?
What does everyone think? No, because remember, you've got to be careful of looking at the actions or the physical evidence in your life and say, oh, well, I'm very responsible when it comes to finances. But really, we've just said self-responsibility is in your soul towards everything, every issue, truth, love and understanding of everything, and it's active desire to do it. So if we're not doing that in one area, how can we be doing it in another? Doesn't really gel.
Thank you. I needed to
Jesus.
Hear that.
Yeah.
In the presentation, you remember that I gave the illustration of digital. Self-responsibility yes. is digital. So either a zero or a one. You either have this passionate desire about everything in your life or you don't. And if you don't about every area of your life, then you're not in God's definition of self-responsibility. You certainly are in the world's definition of it in certain areas, but of course the world's definition of love is completely different to God's. So.
Yeah, yeah, awesome. All right, we're running a bit over. I'll just say a few of the other things that were kind of concrete examples out of harmony with the responsibility principles. Avoiding the causes of things and focusing on the effects. No desire to look at the cause. A lack of desire for truth, an avoidance of truth, a punishment of others in response to truth. They're all evidence of this lack of self-responsibility. Avoiding dealing with any fear. desiring for another person to identify our emotional condition for us rather than us seeking it out for ourselves. So much I wanted to say here. The difference between voicing your appreciation and expressing your appreciation. It's very easy to just say thanks very much. But when we're really self-responsible, when there's a real heartfelt thanks, we utilise our resources to express that thanks, whether it's in giving time or just taking the time to understand everything that went into the gift that you received, using some of your energy, some of your other resources to express gratitude and appreciation. That's a big one where I see, you know, the old saying, talk is cheap, is, well, it's very true. But that's actually an issue of self-responsibility. And there's a lot of others, and hopefully in our second group we'll be able to highlight a few different ones and you'll be able to see it on the video, because I want to get on to compensation. We've got to be conscious of our time. It's being self-responsible. Okay. Last principle in our second session was compensation. Who had some... And remember, this was all about educating us about sin. And we learned also that there's the positive compensation or the pleasurable compensation as well as the painful compensation happening to us all of the time, depending on how in or out of harmony with God's principles we are. So who had some thoughts about how they're living in or out of harmony with the principles? We go to Natalie and then we come to Jada and behind Inna after we're finished. Yep.
Because I'm not sensitive yet to God's laws in my awareness, I've actually really concretely believed that they don't matter. Or not at least until I get to the spirit world. And I've truly believed that if I'm ignorant of them, then they don't apply to me. And I haven't cared that compensation principles are actually trying to show me sin and love.
Yes.
Like where I'm sinning, but like it was profound for me to realise that the compensation's there to show me how to love.
Yes.
As well.
Yes. Yes. Yeah, thank you. Thanks. Thank you. And also I want to highlight as well, we've got to look at our issue of self-responsibility. If we're saying, look, I'm still not sensitive to God's laws, but we've been hearing about them for a long time, where's our state of self-responsibility there? We can't even say, look, I don't even know, really. Yeah. All right, so Jada?
This is out. Wanting an easy way out when I've done something wrong or broken the law, like mm-hmm. God's laws and human laws.
Yep.
And the other thing I was thinking was not really putting much consideration into life after death.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
It's a big issue for a lot of people, isn't it? They just view this life as this is it. And they don't, because if you think about it, it's a lovely observation, Jada, because if you think about it, on earth, okay, there's a lot of fear and there's a lot of injury, isn't there? Which means sometimes we do receive positive compensation automatically onto our soul when we act in harmony with God's principles. We do. But sometimes we're not sensitive to it and we can tell ourselves, well, everyone else is hating on me about this thing. It's not worth it. But if we view our life as like beyond this physical life, we also begin to have faith and knowledge that, well, there's compensatory effects even if they're not right here in front of me. But a lot of people just view it, they excuse their own badness and they try to avoid compensation by saying this is just it. Yeah, just lovely, lovely comment. If we go behind you to, is it Inga or Inna or I don't know how to say it.
It's Inger.
Inga.
I know
Inga.
It's impossible to pronounce if you're not from Scandinavia. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. What did you find?
I don't completely trust the compensation principle because I have this deep feeling. If I live in harmony with God's laws and have a reward for that, there will inevitably come something painful afterwards. Mm. No matter if I live in or out of harmony with the laws, because after something good, there has to come something bad for the balance, kind of. After a good day, there has to be a bad day. It's crazy, but I do have this feeling.
Shows a lot of sadness that we have from our yeah. childhood, I feel, that, you know, there was never a feeling, there was always a feeling of like, oh, what's going to happen next? Just something bad
yeah,
is coming.
Exactly.
So as you work through that sadness, that yeah. I feel that resistance to this principle will lessen.
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you. Does anyone else relate to that example? Yeah, lots of people, hey. Guys, I don't have much more time because we spent a bit of time on responsibility there. I just wanted to highlight to you that many of you are not receiving this the positive compensatory effects in your life because you're not honouring God's principles. And it's just an opportunity there to, it will help grow faith. You know, if you start to examine these principles more fully and to live more in harmony with even just truth, you know, there are positive compensatory effects that you can begin to experience. But a lot of you are missing out on it because you're not wanting just to experiment. Do you know what I mean? So it's something to think about. Yeah, I had noted here, when we call the compensatory effects, the negative compensatory effects in our life, truth, and we have faith in those and say, oh, this is why I shouldn't change. This is why. If you just have a little think about that, it's a very common thing where we look at the state of the way things are right now and say, well, it's all terrible and it's always going to go terrible because it's always gone terrible, not considering that it's not going that well because we're out of harmony with God's principles. And if we came more into harmony with them, maybe it wouldn't be so terrible. Does that make sense? Yeah. All right. I'd love to talk more with you guys about it, and I hope that you've got a lot from those homework exercises. But I do have to wrap up because Jesus is going to wow you today. All right. Just a reminder, this is now the end of your second session, which was all about these principles that form the foundation of the human soul, specific principles that I'm going to talk to you about in our next discussion. And they allow us to obtain some more complex ideas about God's personality and nature, don't they? And as I keep saying, they allow us to enhance and have some more complex concepts of what it means to love, doesn't it? Yeah. And they ensure that laws honour the highest creation, which is the human soul, while still guaranteeing God's authority. So, I hope you enjoy the rest of our day. Thanks so much for your participation. We'll have a 10-minute break and I'll see you back for introducing soul-specific principles.